So, just for your information, this is New Creation Church, if you didn't know where you were. And you picked a good day to come to church, because we're in our series, How It All Works. And for me, it's important how it all works. So I've been at this Christian thing since 1982, been born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, been to Bible college, been in the ministry for 30 years, and I've watched a lot of Christians whose lives suck. There's no victory. And they live and act carnal because they really have no idea what it's all about. From what it looks like is they think, well, I said I was saved, so someday I'm going to heaven, and now I'll just live like hell down on earth and try and enjoy my time and hope it works out okay. But if you remember the story of Adam and Eve, Adam and Eve were put on the planet by God to have dominion. And when they were put on the planet, they were just like Jesus. There was no sin in their lives, no junk. When God put them here, they were a humble and filled with humility couple, meaning humility that they understood that it was all God and it was not us. That's what humility means. You know, it ain't you, it's God. When they walked in that humility, there was no sin on the earth. Therefore, there was no sickness, there was no disease, there was no failure. When Satan, who was an angel created by God, who decided, I want to be God, I want to be in charge, I want to be the cool one, I, what's the middle letter of pride? It's the big I. When Satan came, he did not bring sin and sickness. He brought pride. Pride, when he spoke to Eve, she had been given some instructions about what not to eat and what to eat in the garden. God said, don't eat of this tree. When Satan came, he said, oh, you can eat of that, then you'll know just as much as God. You'll know everything just like he does. And her eyes, because she listened to the lies, began to get big, and she allowed the big eye to come in and remove the humility. And when humility was removed, sin, sickness, and disease came in. When God sent Jesus to this earth, he sent him as a man. I want you to understand this. Jesus did not come empowered with his divinity. The Bible says he left it all there and came as a mere man. I want you to get that. If you think while Jesus was here, the things he did because, well, of course he's God, you're wrong. He is only able to do the things he did after he was filled with the Holy Spirit. For the first 30 years, he did nothing. He walked by the same people on the porches that he would touch later, but he had nothing, no help for them. Y'all follow me on this? When he was filled with the Holy Spirit on the day of his baptism, when the dove came down and the Father spoke, and this is my Son in whom I'm well pleased. Remember that? He became filled with the Holy Ghost, and then he began to do miracles. But when he came to earth, the thing he came to bring was not just the power of God, but to restore humility to mankind. I want you to get this today. We are a people of pride. Pride keeps us from humility. Pride keeps us from the blessings of God. Pride keeps us from God. And pride keeps the things of God out of our life. Jesus came as a man to show us how to restore that humility and live in a humble way so that we could begin to take back that which had been stolen from us. Are y'all following me? The one thing the world needs is not more power. The one thing the world needs is more humility. We don't need to know, well, what is my power and authority? No, you need to know, can I obey God? And will I obey God? Because if I will not obey God, all the other stuff is just junk. And like I said, I've been at this for just a short time, but I've seen lots of quote-unquote faith people who have heard all of the power sermons, all of the let's take the devil out sermons, and they still get beat up, and then they fall away from God, not because they haven't heard the right stuff, they just haven't heard all the right stuff. Amen. Turn over to James chapter 4 once again with me, if you would, please. James chapter 4. Because I want you to be strong. I want you to walk in the full blessings of God. And I want you to get over all the junk that's followed you around your whole life. And it can be done. You can become a new creature, not just in one little phrase, but in actuality. Amen. James chapter 4, verse 6 says this. It says, but he gives, talking about God, he gives more grace. What is grace? Grace is God's ability. Grace is God's power. Grace is God's anointing. Amen? Grace is all the power God's got. And he says, he gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the He resists the what?
Proud.
He resists the proud. And gives grace to the
humble.
In our world, nobody wants to show up as humble because they think it's weakness. Because the other proud people will take advantage of you. But if you truly learn how to walk in humility, God will back you up and you won't have to worry about the other people. When you walk in real humility, true humility, then God empowers what you're doing. And you don't have to prove yourself anymore because now you are something. But because you really are something in God, you don't have to flaunt it. You don't have to parade it. You don't need another Facebook like. You're the real deal. And because you're the real deal, you have a security you've never known. Insecurity leads to sin. Insecurity leads you out of the blessings. Confidence in God and humility towards Him bring the blessings to you. Are y'all out there? And help you to walk in the goodness of God. Verse 7 says this, therefore, submit to God. Now, as you listen to that, as you read that, you should get an understanding. God is not going to make you submit. If I make you submit, you haven't submitted. You're just doing what I made you do. God doesn't want you to do something because He makes you do it. He wants you to do it because you want to do it. You submit to Him because you realize He is God. You realize that everything in His Word is true. And you realize that He's on your side, that He loves you. He cares about you, and it's easy to submit to him if you really and truly understand those things. A lot of people, they're like, why is he trying to make me tithe? He is not trying to make you tithe. He is opening up an avenue for you to do something, one little thing, and then walk in a greater blessing than that one little thing would ever cost you. And your life is full of chaos. Your life is full of trash and junk. And he's saying, if you would just obey me, if you would just humble yourself and walk in obedience, all that junk would begin to disappear. All the trash would begin to, most of your problems come because of the big I. They said this about me. That hurt my pride. I deserve that. I should have this. What are they doing saying, I can't have that? I can have that. Pride. And it's destroying your life. And you never get all that garbage you think you want anyway. Verse 7 says, therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. What comes first? Submission. And what I've watched, and I watched a lot of faith people, man, they're shouting, devil, you get out of here, and I resist you, devil, and they're doing all the resistance stuff, but it don't work for them. I've watched so many people say, it just doesn't work. I claim my healing, it doesn't work. It doesn't work if you are not submitted to God. Because if you're not submitted to God, you have no authority to walk in, because it's not your authority, it's his, and he doesn't give his authority to your pride. You have to walk in his authority, which means you're submitted to him, you are humble, you're submitted, and he's the boss. Amen. Amen. And the Bible calls that crucifying the flesh. You have to start dealing with you and get you out of the picture. And the big I, you will never have its burial ceremony. Because you will deal with pride for the rest of your life, but you can get better at dealing with it. Amen. Pride is the number one downfall. That's what Satan brought into the earth, was pride. That's what you have been leading, giving yourself to, which keeps you from the things of God, the blessings of God, the real blessings of God. Like I mentioned before, when we didn't tithe, I mean, my life sucked. It was, dear Lord. I mean, we got to do fun things on occasion, but they didn't last very long. And there wasn't real joy and real peace. Y'all follow me. I mean, you can get fun distractions, but even they can turn into garbage. Y'all follow me on this. You can go through the motions of having natural fun, but it'll all explode on you. And it ends up being no fun. I mean, you think you're just going to have a little drink, and the next thing you know, you're an alcoholic. You think you're going to have some fun with friends, and the next thing you know, you're addicted to some drug, and then you're doing crazy things. That's not the will of God for you. God's will is for you to live peacefully, powerfully, in control, full of the Holy Ghost and power, and not be concerned about what anybody thinks about you at all. Because now your only concern is, God, how can I please you? Because, Lord, you are so good to me. I wake up every morning in our house, the house we've got, and I just walk downstairs. I think, Lord, when we first moved into that house, I'd wake up in the middle of the night and just go down and stand at the front door and think, God, how in the world did you ever do this? Because we live in a house better than anything we've ever lived in. Better than anything I've ever lived in. And I know it wasn't us. It was God. And I wake up sometimes, I just walk to the house and I think, thank you, Lord. Lord, you are so good. Why? Because I know it wasn't me. Are you all out there? Yes. See, we're getting ready tonight. We're leaving for Greece. We're going to go teach in 3 separate Bible colleges for 2 weeks. busier than a hound dog. People say, well, you're going on vacation. Yeah, I wish it was a vacation. I mean, we will get to see some things, I'm sure. But when I think about, for 20 years, I was a log truck driver. For most of that, I didn't care for God, didn't know God. For most of that, I was an angry, prideful, arrogant me. And I'm thinking about going to Greece. And I know something. You ever seen, if you ever see a fence post with a turtle on the top of it, can you envision that? A fence post with a turtle on top? Can you envision that? Not at me. Can you envision a turtle on top of a fence post? Well, you know one thing. If a turtle is on a fence post, he didn't get there by himself. Right? I know one thing. I didn't get where I am by myself. I did not dream this up. I did not do this. It's me following God. Him leading, him directing, him being in charge. Are you out there? I had a young man this morning. He came up and rededicated his life after the first service. And he says, so when did you decide you wanted to become a pastor? Because he's excited about what's going on. I said, I never decided to be a pastor. He's like, what? See, most people think you decide what you want to be. Without Christ as the center of your life, you will decide wrong. And you will fill your life with junk that's meaningless. And you will go nowhere. The key to success is humility. Humbleness before God. And not deciding what you think you should be. But finding out what has God put in you. And then working on the baselines of just doing whatever he's called you to do at the very bottom. Being faithful to that. Let him develop in you your gift that he's given you. Every one of you has a gift in here. Most of you are so far from what it is, you have no clue. Because you've tried to dream up what you think it would be a good one. And you need to get on your face and just shut your mouth for a couple hours. Read your Bible every day and seek the Lord. Let him show you. I remember one time we were in a service in Oklahoma, and this guy was praying for people. I went up for something. I don't even remember what for, though. And he's going down the line. He's just going, you know, almost sweet two guy, and he's just praying for people as he comes down. And he gets to me and he goes, "Rah!" And I fell on the floor and slid back underneath two rows of chairs. The power of God. And I'm laying there, and the Lord is saying, "Be still and know that I am God." He was trying to tell me something. He says, "You're mouthing off too much. Just shut up and listen." See, I'm a log truck driver. He can talk to me like a log truck driver instead of a schoolgirl. People think, well, I don't know if it was the Lord. I didn't hear a thee or a thou. He don't talk to you in old English. He talks to you in your language. Y'all out there? Huh? But see, he is going to get to you when you come to him. Nowhere in the Bible do you find where it says he's coming to you. He says, if you desire me, you come. Who makes the first move? You do. But when you come, you should at least have enough sense to shut up and listen. Instead of going to God and then telling him everything you know. He already knows what little you know. And he knows how little you know it. It would be wise, I mean, at least common sense, that if you're in the presence of somebody who knows more than you do, that you listen. And the one thing he wants to teach you and I about is humility. How to be humble. But as we talk about this, how does it all work? We were reading Judges yesterday and today. Y'all remember that? How many are reading through the Bible with us, with our plan? How many are reading with some other plan? Okay, let me tell you something. If you are not reading the Bible every day, you're not going to make it. The devil will see to it. You have no input of faith. Nothing for God to work with. And you're not going to make it. You're pulling the wool over your own eyes. You have to be in the Word every day, and you have to pray, have a prayer life. If you don't, the devil will get you into sin. He'll get you into guilt and shame, and then he'll accuse you and keep you away from God. He knows how it works. If he can get you into sin and make you feel bad about what you've done, and you don't understand how the Bible really works and how God really works, you'll stay in shame. And all the time that God says, I'll forgive you if you confess your sin, you stay away because you feel ashamed. And you go through the motions of being a Christian, but you ain't living the life. You lost it all. And the Bible says, confess your sins and I'll forgive you. And what we do is we go, okay, God, forgive me. Okay, Lord, forgive me. And then go right back to doing the same thing because he says you have to confess the sin first. But we like to go, oh, forgive me, and think we're doing the right thing because we don't have to really open our heart. We don't have to really get real. And if we don't confess it, then we can keep doing it. God says, confess the sin. And what I do is I say, Lord, you know what I did, and I know what I did, and then I tell him what it was I did. I make sure he knows that I know what I did. And I'm not shining on, this is real, because I don't want to do it anymore. I don't want to keep doing it. Are you out there? When you don't confess your sins, it's because you want to keep doing it. And if you want to keep doing it, you might as well quit the church business and quit all the other monkey Christian business because you ain't one. Just go out until you hit rock bottom. And then if you come to your senses at that time, then repent and come back. But don't be the kind of Christian that gives all the rest of us a bad name because people watch you and know what you're doing. And then they think, yeah, there's just more of them sinning Christians. They're just like we are. We don't need you. We need you living right because you want to live right. We need you living right because you found out how good it is to live right. We need you to go boldly to the throne of grace in a time of need to receive those things you need. Amen? Why? Because I have a relationship with my Father. Just because you're a Christian doesn't mean you're never going to sin again. You're going to. Are you out there? You're not going to become a Christian and all of a sudden, I never sin. Now you're a liar. You're going to sin, but it's going to diminish. And you're going to get better at getting rid of it quicker, and it's not going to have the stronghold in your life. Amen. Are you out there? You know, a lot of times, you know, my first thing the Lord dealt with me, I think it was the first thing he dealt with me, and you've heard this story if you've been here, is, you know, I'm driving my log truck, and I'll never forget it. I'm coming south, just starting around Klamath Lake, coming into Klamath Falls down there, load of logs, and it's summertime, and the girls are hitchhiking with nothing on hardly. And I'm just an eyeball. I'm married with three kids. Well, two and a half kids. And this up by the weigh scales, just before they get there, this girl's out there, she's got hardly anything on, she's hitchhiking, and I'm like, eyeball it. And the Lord says, don't do that. I'm like, don't do what? He says, don't look at other women. I'm like, I wasn't lusted or anything. I wasn't like undressed or anything. I was just looking. He says, stop it. He says, when you do see one you want to look at, look the other way. The first thing God tells you will be an opportunity to obey. If you don't obey, he will quit talking to you. To this day, I'm a guy. Every guy in here, it does not take us 12 hours to look at a girl and see if we should keep looking. We can look and see if that's a, yeah. Well, you guys just keep looking straight ahead, especially if your wife is here. Come on, talking the truth. A guy still sees a girl, and I have excellent peripheral vision. I just do. I've always had excellent. I can spot them from the back of my head. And I still turn the other way. Because I know, even after 30-some years of doing this, the temptation can still be acted upon. I don't feed it, I don't give into it, but it's there. And so I just look the other way and I take my mind with it. Whatever your thing is, you have to obey God. And like I said before, if you don't obey him, he will quit talking to you. And then being the good, prideful person that you are, you will blame it on him when the garbage shows up. God, why didn't you help me? Why did you do this? Why did you allow this, God? And you'll end up like Saul, not even realizing the Spirit has left you. This is really good today. Because this is how it all works. It's not in the shouting. Oh, I resist you, devil. It's in the Lord. If it wasn't for you, I'd be nothing. If it wasn't for you, Father, there'd be nothing going on here. And so back to Judges, chapter 1. They've been told to take this land. And God said, what's she want? I'm sorry.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt.
You are interrupting.
I am. How do you get him to talk to you again? After you've ignored his command.
That's a good question. That's a good question. Is this for you?
Yeah.
The way you do it, the Bible says that you enter into his courts with praise and thanksgiving. You just begin thanking him for his goodness and thanking him that he's a good God. Go to Psalm 34 and it says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. And you just start opening up to him and you just say, Lord, I just love you. I just love you. And then when you've been in there for a little while, say, Father, you know I've sinned. I know I've sinned. And this is the sin. You don't have to tell anybody else. You say, this is a sin. Say, Father, forgive me. I want to honor you with my life. And he says, no matter what the sin was, no matter how bad it was, He says in 1 John 1:9, he says, I am faithful to forgive you and cleanse you and restore you. And he will never bring it up again. He will never beat you with it again. He will just say, well done. And you'll be restored, and he'll be talking to you again. Would you like to do that right now? Stand up. Are you born again?
I was.
Well, you still are. You only get born again once. You can go cold, and you can turn the other way. But you're still a child of God. You just have to come back home. You want to come back home?
Yeah.
Okay, say, Father.
Father.
I believe.
That Jesus Christ.
Is the Son of God.
Is the Son of God.
You believe that?
I do.
Say, Father.
Father.
I believe. That Jesus died on the cross for me. Paid the price for my sins. Jesus. I make you my Lord.
My Savior.
My Healer.
And my Redeemer.
And I ask you. In Jesus' name. To forgive me.
Of my sins.
Don't say it out loud. Don't say it so we can hear you. But could you just tell him what the sins are? Just quietly, just say, Lord, you know what they are. I know what they are. And I ask you to forgive me. Do it. Say, I ask you to forgive me.
Ask you to forgive me.
See me smiling at you?
I do.
Listen to me. That's God smiling at you. He says, well done, sweetheart. Welcome back. He says, I forgive you, I cleanse you, and I restore you. You're mine again. We're in good shape. In Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Thank you.
Say thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus. 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 Don't any of you think or say, man, that was good, Pastor. Because it wasn't me. If it was good, it's God. Are y'all out there? You need to learn that you do not need the praises of God, of men. You don't even want them. If it wasn't God working this whole situation out, it never would have happened. God's working on her heart because I'm preaching the word. Whatever word you preach is the word the Holy Spirit is going to back up. The Holy Spirit's working on her because her heart's obviously tender right now. To come back, to be forgiven. Everybody in here who has sin in their life wants to be forgiven. They just don't know how, or the pride is just too much to let them. Thank you, sweetheart, that you submitted to humility and beat pride. Well, you did have a little part to play in that, though. Amen. But do you see that? If it's good, it's God. If it's bad, it's me. I'm serious. And it needs to be a reality in your life, not just a cute saying. Get over you needing to take credit for stuff. You can't do anything that's worth taking credit for without God. And if you needed God to do it, you didn't do it. And if you didn't do it, why would you take credit for it? Huh? So back to Judges. They were told to clean out the land, to get rid of all the people who were not godly people. And they went through the land, but they wouldn't do it. They kind of cleaned them out, but then they let them stay in the cities. And then they lived with them for years. And then they took those people as wives, and they kept merging. And then the next thing you know, they are bowing down to the gods of the people they were supposed to kick out. In today's language, those people and things they were supposed to get out of their lives are sin to you. You're supposed to deal with sin and not allow it in your life. You following me? When sin is in your life, you're not supposed to make friends with it. You're supposed to deal with it and get it out. Why? Because God hates sin, because if you hang around sin long enough, it will influence your life back to sin. You cannot get your fellowship from sinners. We're here to reach them. We're not here to get our fellowship from them. They have no life to give you. You're supposed to be giving them God's life and your life, but you're not supposed to be taking your fellowship. Well, my best friends, they do drugs and stuff. Well, you should get rid of them as your best friends then. Well, why? I like them. And because you will go right back to that. Well, but I'm strong. No, you're not. You're stupid. You will give in and you will go back. The devil knows which buttons to push on you. He's been pushing them. That's what got you there in the first place. And if you don't get full of God and resist him, you'll go right back. And so God has told them, take this country and get rid of everybody. And in Judges chapter 2, verse 1, it says, then the angel of the Lord came up from Gilgal to Bochim and said, I led you up from Egypt and brought you to the land of which I swore to your fathers. And I said, watch this, I will never break my covenant with you. And you shall make no covenant with the inhabitants of this land. For you, that means no covenants with the sin of this land. No covenants. You shall tear down their altars. But you have not obeyed my voice. Why have you done this? God is, he's looking at him and saying, I told you how to stay safe and how to stay out of trouble. But you didn't obey me. Why have you done this? And then utter chaos came in and destroyed all of them. Because they would not obey him. Obeying him is putting him above what you think. It takes humility to obey God at the expense of what you think other people will think of you. That's why so many Christians, not this group, okay, but the other churches we preach at, the Christians no longer can even bring a Bible because somebody might see them. Dear God, if you can't be seen with your Bible, you ain't much of a Christian. I'm not saying you got to show it off, but if that offends somebody and that bothers you, you ain't got much Christian in you. You definitely aren't witnessing to anybody. You're definitely not leading people to Christ. You're definitely not showing any power of God because you ain't got none. Because it takes commitment to God and humility in God. Right? Yes. This young lady here, what was your name again, sweetheart?
Anastasia.
You don't have a mic, I can't hear you.
Oh, Anastasia.
Anastasia? Oh, we have two Anastasias here now. So Anastasia, you're on her for prayer. Okay, her name is Anastasia. Those of us in here who are people of prayer, we're going to lift you up every day. You just did a great thing. But the devil's not going, oh, good, look what she did. Isn't that awesome? The devil is not right now trying to figure out how he's going to get Anastasia back. And if she hangs around with weakling Christians, she'll end up back. But if she hangs around us who pray and live what we pray and live how we read the word, and we support her, she'll make it. But she needs our help. She needs God's help. She needs her help. As for me, she's got it. Are you out there? See, you need that kind of help too, but you need to make a commitment. God, I'm going to put you first. No more other junk first. You first. All right, we're going to be at this when we get back from Greece, because this is, if you don't understand how this all works, you're going to be shouting and worshiping, and ain't nothing going to be happening, because the foundation is humility. The foundation is learning how to obey God because you want to obey God. Right? So that you can walk in all the blessings that God has. I actually liked log truck driving. I loved being up in the mountains. I loved being up there when the sun came up and when the sun went down. I loved the mountains. But I've learned to like this. Y'all out there? I wonder where you're stuck thinking you like something, but it's not really what God has for you. I wonder how many of you are stuck in a hole thinking, well, I want to be this. I want to be that. Without getting with God and finding out what He put in you. I wonder, too, how many people, and I watch this all the time, they're bragging, I'm an intercessor. I'm a prayer warrior. I'm a this. I'm a that. Oh, shut up. One thing I've learned after 30-some years in the ministry is if you got to tell me what you are, you ain't. Did I tell you the story about the peach tree? So down in Northern California, they got the big trees right on the border, Oregon. And there's this forest of big trees. And right in the middle is this little scrub pear tree. And it's the dead of winter. No leaves, no nothing. The big trees, they're like, man, we must be the greatest trees on earth. We're green all year long. Look how big we are. Aren't we big? We're big. We're going, and they're talking to each other about how great they are. And the little scrub thing is going, I'm a pear tree. I'm a pear tree. Shut up, little scrub bush. Shut up. We're the big trees around here. Look how green we are. Look how big we are. I'm a pear tree. I'm a pear tree. Look, I'm a pear tree. Stupid little scrub bush, shut up. That's what a lot of Christians are like. I'm a pear tree. I'm a prophet. I'm an evangelist. I'm a pastor. If the pear tree would just shut up until it had pears. If it had pears, it wouldn't have to tell everybody what it was. They could look and see, oh, it's a pear tree. If you will be submitted to God, become faithful to God, do in the little things what God has for you without trying to claim to be a this or a that, and just develop until the fruit is there. You won't have to tell everybody what you are. We'll know. Well, I'm a this. No, you're not. I can tell you don't even think you're a that. Because if you were a that, you wouldn't have to tell me. Are y'all out there? Y'all good? So God says, why don't you obey me? How come you don't obey God? My prayer is that you will. My prayer is that you'll get over yourself. Quit trying to be a somebody and be who Christ made you to be. Start at the very, you don't start out on a ladder at the top. You start out at the bottom. One rung at a time, you get to the top. Everybody wants to start at the top of the ladder. You don't start there. Amen. Whatever's going on in your life, you need to get on your face before God for a couple hours. You need to read your Bible every day. If you're not reading your Bible every day, you are deceiving yourselves. Get our Bible reading schedule. Get some Bible reading schedule. Read your Bible every day. Start off with 5, 10, 15 minutes of prayer time. What is prayer? That's talking to God. Father, I love you. I bless you. I mean, when I first got started in that log truck, I spent most of the day because I didn't know what to do. I didn't have a pastor like me. And I would just say, Father, thank you, Lord. Thank you all day. I just thank him for blessing me. Thank you, Lord, for all your good stuff. Bless you, Father. Lord, I love you. You're a good God. Thank you, stuff. I'd get out of the truck and some guy would be standing there and say, praise you, Lord, and because I'm still in the spirit. I haven't come back down yet. And then I go, oh, sorry. How you doing? Are y'all out there? But you've got to get into his presence, spend some time with him, get on your face, say and talk to him about your day. Lord, is there any, what do you have for today? What do you want to do for today? What's your plan for my life? What's your plan for today? Instead of trying to get him to bless your plan, shut your plan down and find out what his plan is. I would rather walk into a plan that's blessed than to try and come up with a plan and see if I can get him, talk him into blessing it. Right? And you need to do that. You all need to just get on your face at home. You don't need to shout to everybody. You can lay there in your bed and just talk in tongues without even waking up your spouse. You need to get filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen.